Hello again, and welcome to the second video in this programme of music inspired by poetry in some way or other. Arnold Bax wrote his five-movement quasi-symphony Spring Fire in 1913. He called it an attempt to describe the first uprush and impulse of spring in the woods. And he took as his inspiration the first chorus of a verse drama by Algernon Swinburne, Atalanta in Caledon. Swinburne tried to recreate in English the spirit and form of Greek tragedy, and Bax was a sucker for this sort of stuff. He often alluded to paganism and mysticism and Celtic rites in his music. Swinburne's drama retold the Greek myth of the killing of the wild Caledonian boar by a band of heroes. A band that included the huntress Atalanta. Bax was concerned with, shall we say, the earthier aspects of Greek mythology. And the fourth movement is a romance he called Woodland Love. Here's what Swinburne wrote. For winter's rains and ruins are over, and all the seasons of snow and sins, the days of dividing lover and lover, the light that loses, the night that wins, blossom by blossom, the spring begins. And I think you can catch that in this movement with its very atmospheric solos echoed by a playful flute and luscious clarinet. And there are harps and piano adding another layer to the whole piece. So let's hear it now. This is from Spring Fire by Arnold Bax.
Thank you.
The movement died away, as Bax wrote, it quotes, in some strange harmony, as though the forest lovers had become drugged with their own ecstatic dream. Heady stuff, and really it provides the link to the next piece you're going to hear. Excuse me, Alexander Scriabin's The Poem of Ecstasy. Scriabin wrote this 20-minute work between 1905 and 1908, and it probably took him that long because he also wrote a poem of over 300 lines to accompany the music, though not to be recited with it. Scriabin was, let's not beat about the bush, he was an oddball. And he wrote what you and I might think of as a load of old tosh about this music. Here are just two sentences. The poem of ecstasy is the joy of liberated action. The cosmos, i.e. spirit, is eternal creation without external motivation, a divine play of worlds. The creative spirit, i.e. the universe at play, is not conscious of the absoluteness of its creativeness, having subordinated itself to a finality and made creativity a means towards an end. I'll be asking you questions about that at the end of the programme. I'm much too bashful to tell you in more graphic detail what Scriabin had in mind when he wrote the poem of ecstasy, but perhaps you can guess from the title. Certainly the poem he wrote to accompany the music leaves nothing to the imagination. However, I hope that hasn't put you off to this music, for I see it as I said in the first video, the centrepiece of this programme. I think it shows that Scriabin's innate talent sometimes gets superseded by his somewhat bizarre philosophy. For all his eccentricities, and he had a great many, Scriabin was very highly regarded in Russia. He died of septicemia in 1915, and his funeral in Moscow was attended by so many admirers that it had to be ticketed. Rachmaninoff was a pallbearer at the funeral. And when whenever it was, Yuri Gagarin became the first man in space, the state radio in the Soviet Union played the poem of ecstasy as a kind of theme tune to the flight. So let's hear it then. This piece was written for a very large orchestra, and it's full of lush and sensuous textures, as well as, well, let's call it an ecstatic ending.
Thank you.
I'm not sure I can adequately describe the music you just heard. I find it to be quite extraordinary. Well, that was going to be the end of this programme. It certainly is the end of this video. But the other day I thought I would add one more piece and one more video. Let's call it an adjunct to the main programme. It's not all that often that I feature very popular, very well-known pieces of music in programmes, but I thought I'd do so here. I wanted to include, as an add-on, Vaughan Williams' The Lark Ascending, a favourite of Classic FM and its listeners. I tried in vain to find out how many recordings there are of this music. Well over 100, one source I read said. I'll tell you later why I chose the recording I've chosen, but first just a wee bit of information about The Lark Ascending. Vaughan Williams started working on it in 1914, just as World War I broke out, and he revised it to the version we now know in 1920. He was actually arrested for writing this music. He was on holiday in Margate and he was sitting outside writing some notes when a young boy spotted him. He had a wee look at what he was writing and he thought he was writing in a secret code, and so he told a policeman. And Vaughan Williams was arrested and he was briefly held before being released without charge. The music was inspired by a long poem of the same name, The Lark Ascending, by the English poet George Meredith. It tells the story of a skylark singing an impossibly beautiful song. For singing till his heaven fills, 'tis love of earth that he instills, and ever winging up and up our valley is his golden cup. And he the wine which overflows to give with him as he goes, to beg your pardon, to lift us with him as he goes. I knew I'd get that wrong. Vaughan Williams gave The Lark Ascending the subtitle Romance, and that's a word he tended to use for his slow, contemplative music. So you're going to hear The Lark Ascending in video 3, along with my reasons for choosing the recording that I did. Thank you.